discrete transformations on spin-off field, but of course they can be defined on any kind of field. We are discussing the spin-off. I'm calling it field, but for us it's still a wave function, right? But okay, it will soon become a field and an operator, actually. But so okay, so so these are this C, P, and T, right? And we saw how C and P act on the spinors. So for, well, the simplest, of course, is P, say psi P of X prime is some matrix, which actually is with some phase, which you choose for your convenience, some is psi of X, right? And X prime is X0 minus X, right? Is the parity transformation, flipping the sign of the spatial components of it. So this is the transformed field in the transformed point, right? In this way, and is related by some matrix to the old one. And for C, C was involved, it involved some complex conjugation, so we define psi C. This does not act on the space-time, it acts only on the internal degrees of freedom, and this was defined to be C psi bar transpose, right, where C is some matrix, which is charge conjugation matrix, whose property is that C gamma mu transpose C minus 1 is minus gamma mu. This is what it does. It converts the transpose of the gamma matrix with minus the gamma matrices. And psi bar is what we said. Psi bar is psi dagger gamma 0. Transpose, because this should be a column spinor, right? So you take the transpose, because this is a row spinor, right? Just that. And in the particular basis that we have taken, C was, I think, gamma 0, gamma 2, something like that. Okay. Well, that is again is up to a phase. Overall, is a minus sign. Okay. And so then the obvious question somebody asked about T. Okay. Say T acting again. I'm discussing particular case where it acts on spinors. So T, what it does? T, of course, x zero goes to minus x zero. And x prime goes to x, sorry, x goes to x, right? This is the time inversion, that's all. Now, so these are symmetries of the Dirac equation, in the sense that the transformed field obeyed the same equation, right? In this case, there was a change in the charge. If you couple the spinor to some external gauge potential, it flipped the charge. Okay, but apart from that, so suppose you switch off the charge, it obeys the same type, the same equation. And so here, for the time inversion, again, one has a similar structure. So say I can call it psi p of x prime, where x prime is minus x zero x, right? And this is again some matrix U, but now what one finds is that it involves the complex conjugation of the wave function. Okay. So with the appropriate choice of this, this object obeys the same equation. The Dirac equation is has the same form. Now to see that, well, one just takes the Dirac I gamma mu d mu minus n. Again, we don't include some external field. Let's just take the standard free Dirac equation. Is this, take the star of this. This is star, there is a minus here, right? And star. And now, what is gamma mu star? Well, that depends on the basis that we choose. Let's choose our basis, Dirac's basis. Gamma zero is real, right? Gamma zero star is gamma zero. Is 1 minus 1. No, so it's real. And also the other basis, which is the wild basis, also is real, because the only difference is that, you remember, gamma zero Dirac, say, is 1 minus 1. Gamma zero, let me call it wild, is 0, 1, 1, 0, so they are both real, right? And the gamma i's are the same. Okay, so this is gamma zero, and what about gamma one? Gamma one is also real, because gamma one involves sigma one. No, sigma one is a real matrix, right? Gamma two star. Now, gamma 2 involves sigma 2. Sigma 2 is purely imaginary, so this picks a minus sign. And gamma 3 is real, so gamma 3 star is gamma 3, right? This is the what happens, right? So we would like, okay, so what is the idea here? There is a minus here, right? So we would like to get an equation which is I gamma mu d mu prime, right? The mu prime being the minus the zero and the I the same, right? And so to achieve that, we have to find some matrix which does what? Okay, this is okay because the minus sign which is here, it's compensated by the minus sign which is here, right? So the problem is the minus signs which are in the along the spatial directions. So, in particular, this is fine because this minus sign here, right, compensates this minus sign here. So the problem is the fact that gamma 1 and gamma 3, since they are real, the star doesn't do anything, but there is over a minus sign that we should get rid of, right? This is the point. And to do that, what we can do is just, so we define, so there is a matrix. Well, so what would be a matrix which flips the signs of the gamma 1 and gamma 3 and does not touch these others, right? This is the point. Well, if you think about it a little bit, you see that there is something like gamma 1, gamma 3, it should be, right? Let me call it UT. Up to a phase which is always there, because gamma 1, gamma 3, so if you do ut gamma mu ut minus 1, this is what we should do, no? This is equal to what, okay? For gamma 0, if this is gamma 0, so gamma ut minus 1 is what? The inverse is just gamma 3, gamma 1, right? Gamma 3, gamma 1 times gamma 1, gamma 3 is 1, right? Because gamma 3 squared is minus 1, gamma 1 squared is minus 1, so. You see here, if you take gamma 0 here, both gamma 1 and gamma 3 anti-commute with gamma 0, right? So you get two minus signs, so nothing, right? This is gamma 0, so this is gamma 0, which is okay, right? Gamma 2 also, this stays gamma 2 because, again, this is gamma 3, gamma 1, both anti-commute to gamma 2, so they don't change. When you cross, you take, no, you pass through gamma 2. So these are okay, but what is then the other is gamma 1 and gamma 3. Clearly now there is a problem, there is a change in sign because here it involves gamma 1, for example. Now, gamma 1 doesn't do anything to gamma 1. right? But gamma 3 does picks a minus sign, so this is minus gamma 1, and gamma 3 is the same, right? Gamma 3 also picks a minus sign, minus gamma 3, no? Because gamma 3 doesn't do anything to gamma 3, but gamma 1 anti-commutes gamma 3. So you pick the two minus signs that you wanted here, right? So if you multiply, so this the question, the issue is that multiply this equation with ut minus I gamma mu star d mu minus m ut minus 1 ut psi star, right? This is what you get, no? This is identity here. And then here, this gives precisely I gamma mu d mu prime minus m acting on this thing, ut psi star. And this is what we call ut not transpose, stands for time, okay? This is what we call psi prime x prime. Psi t x prime, sorry. The transformed, right? Okay? So then the equation has the same form also in the time reversal frame. So this is the way time reversal work for the spin. So there is this matrix U, which is not surprising. It is there for the charge conjugation, also for the time inversion, the space inversion. And then there is a complex conjugate, similarly to the charge conjugation, which involves also complex conjugation. Okay, this is the way it works. Now, this discussion about CPT and the product of them being always a symmetry, so CPT, the product of all the three, always preserved. This is to be discussed, of course, in quantum field theory, okay? Quantum field theory, what you do, as you will see, you will interpret this psi not as a wave function, but as a field. So let me you expand the field, all the fields, the spinor, the scalars, the vectors in Fourier series, right, e to the minus I dx. Here you put, for example, for the spinor, the solutions of the Dirac equation, the U that we discussed, and some coefficients here, which are A. These are operators, creation operators, like harmonic oscillator creation operators, labeled by the momentum. And here you put B dagger, P, some other, this is a creation, extraction, annihilation operator, this is a creation operator. They are different because psi is not real, okay? So you should not have the complex conjugate here. If you put the negative energy solution, e to the ipx, this is the way you expand, you will see in QED how you expand the electron, positron field, and so this destroys electrons, this creates positrons, and then you can take psi bar and it will be the bar of this, okay? And so then this CPT will act also on this creation annihilation operators, right? For example, for the charge conjugation, it will change A, the creation annihilation operator for the electron, with the B, which are creation annihilation operator for the positron. Okay, particle, antiparticle, and all this, okay? So this you will see in full detail. Actually, this is an integral over dp, d3p. or some normalization, something like that. You have to normalize properly in such a way that psi has the right commutation, anti-commutation relations. Okay. So this will be the subject of the next course. Okay. But at this level, okay, we are treating this as a just ordinary wave function. Okay, we are not. Okay, so this is what this is. This, so this concludes C, P, and T. By the way, P is already broken in nature by weak interaction, but also CP is broken by some process, the KK bar system. Okay. And so if CP is broken, then also T is broken, right? In such a way that the product of the all of the three is preserved, right? This is what happens in nature. The other thing I wanted to mention was that this is the type of argument. Okay, so this is discussed also in the lecture notes. The other thing is, we mentioned that when we studied Dirac equation, we had this thing, no? The I dt psi is alpha dot p, right? Plus beta m, no? Psi. So, and this is the Hamiltonian. This we can interpret as the Dirac Hamiltonian, no? See, this is what replaces I dt is p squared over 2m, right? This is the non-relativistic dispersion relation, and this is the relativistic dispersion relation. Now, we already said that, okay, so if m is not zero, then we are forced to have 4 by 4 matrices, right? Alpha and beta are 4 by 4. But if m is zero, there is no beta, right? So we just need to get, I mean, to have the right algebra for the alphas, right? And then we can make it 2 by 2, because if you have this equation, I dt psi is alpha dot p psi equal to like that, then alpha you can take the Pauli matrices. This is good. Okay. And but this is a two-component equation, right? Just these are 2 by 2, so this is a two-component equation. And this is the, so you have some E equal to P dot sigma, right? This is the relation, right? On psi, no? So if you go to momentum space, so you have E, U is P dot sigma U, right? And so this, by the way, this equation says that if you divide by E, you have P dot sigma over E on the two-component spinor is equal to 1, right? No. But this is what? P dot sigma is the same as P, right? Because we are massless, no? So this is T here. So this is nothing but sigma dot n, right? This thing here. Unit vector. So this says that this spinor has to be eigenstate of sigma dot n with eigenvalue say 1. And this is the spin along the direction of motion of the particle. So this is the helicity, right? And here, of course, who tells you what is the sign here? You could have also the minus, right? So this can be 1 or minus 1. So this is the right-handed, this you may call it right-handed because the spin is parallel to the direction of flight. The other left-handed because the spin is anti-parallel, okay? The same you can get if you start, of course, from four dimensions after all. I can set this to zero and in our Dirac equation, 4 by 4, right? In which case, for example, if you start from just I gamma mu p mu now, right, psi equal to zero, this is the equation now, there is no m, right? It's a very, okay, the most convenient thing now is to choose the basis for gamma matrices, which is the one, the vial, what I call vial, in which gamma zero is 0, 1, 1, 0, and gamma i's are 0, sigma I, minus sigma I, 0. Okay. They obey the same algebra. And so this gives, you see, two decoupled equations, right? Because what you have zero, this is I gamma mu d mu, sorry. So this is one, this E minus P dot sigma here, right? And here is E plus P dot sigma, no? Zero, no? On, say, psi plus, psi minus, the two components, right? This is the equation, no? So you see now that these two, the equations for psi plus and psi minus decouple, right? They are not coupled. They couple if there is a mass term. Otherwise, you get two equations, one for psi minus and one for psi plus, right? E minus P sigma psi plus psi minus equal to zero. E plus P sigma psi plus equal to zero, which are the same, no? Okay, so we have the same thing if you started from. You can say, what happens then, but what why, I mean, should I choose this basis? If you choose the old basis, 1 minus 1, what happens? Well, apparently then you have two coupled equations, right? Because then in this, okay, just comment about that. Of course, things should not matter, right? The basis should not be a problem, should not be relevant. In this case, you have E minus P dot sigma, right? And then you have P dot sigma and then minus E, right? Or say psi 1, psi 2. Now you may say E psi 1 minus P dot sigma psi 2. One is this and the other is P dot sigma psi 1, okay, minus E psi 2. But you can take combination of this and find two equations which look like this. Take the sum and the difference of psi 1 and psi 2, right? So that must be not a problem, right? So this is the two component notation. And yeah. By the way, one of the things that I would, since we are talking of the Dirac Hamiltonian, one may ask, what quantities commute with this Hamiltonian? Okay, quantities observable which commute with the Hamiltonian are conserved, right? That what the time evolution equation gives, right? So let me ask you few observables and see what they are. There are various observables related with the, say, angular momentum. So first is, say, you have the orbital angular momentum, L, and then the spin, let me call it sigma, right? S, we call it J, maybe, yeah. Okay. And then you have L plus J. So which of the three is conserved? Only the last one is conserved. The total angular momentum, which is made out of the orbital one and the internal one. Remember, the J we define to be Ji is 1 half epsilon I Jk sigma Jk, right? That is involved the spin. Okay. Whereas L, what is L? Li, the orbital angular momentum is what? What do you think?
The cross product of x and p.
Yeah, it's the cross product of x and p, which is, say, epsilon I j, like that, right? Epsilon I j k, x j p k, right? So L1 is x2 p3 minus x3 p2 and so on. And the sum is the sum. And finally you have the helicity also. Helicity, H helicity, or helicity, is the spin dotted with the direction, say with sigma, no, J, call it J, J dot N, where N is proportional to P, right? Dot P, say, is the same, right? Is the spin projected on the direction of flight, no? So, there are four observables here, which commute with H. We said already, this should commute, right? The total, and then also this commutes, actually. Also the spin commutes, the helicity commutes, okay? Okay, this is something to check, so you can check that. Verify this. Compute the commutators of this with that, the HD, J with this, and the sum. Once you have the commutators on, you may verify that the sum is zero. And then the helicity. Verify that this with HD is zero, this with HD is zero, but these are not zero. So the, yeah, okay, this is the. Huh? What was the question?
Is it homework?
Yeah, this is homework. Of course, here when you commute L, right, since L is this, there is P here. P, of course, does not commute with X, right? The commutator P with X is what is the canonical commutator. And similarly, J, since it involves the sigmas, Pauli matrices won't commute with the alphas, right? No. So, but the sum of the two, if one puts the correct normalization, of course, should be, the sum should be zero. It is zero.
If P is equal to zero, then that will commute, I guess.
If P is zero?
Yeah.
Yeah, probably. Beta is... If P is zero, coincides with beta, right? But beta is what? Is 1, 0, 0, minus 1.
Yeah. Then
the city
has no meaning,
you
know, the
spirit direction. No, the city not, but you may ask about these things. Of course, L commutes, right? L clearly commutes with this is constant, right? So also the sigma, the J should commute. So this is one of the properties of the Dirac operator. So in fact, when one of the calculations, we didn't do any real calculation in this. It was just kinematics, just properties, right? One of the problems is that is interesting is if you remaining in the context of first quantization where you consider psi as a wave function, so okay, you may add to the Dirac equation the Coulomb potential, no, 1 over r potential, and this would give the sort of relativistic version of the hydrogen atom, right? 1 over r, like in the Schrödinger equation, you have 1 over r potential gives the energy levels of the hydrogen atom and the non-relativistic. So if one does that for Dirac equation, one should find also some relativistic corrections to the energy levels of the hydrogen atom. In fact, this is what one does, and one finds that. And one uses precisely the fact that this object is conserved to reduce the problem. It's more complicated than the non-relativistic version, where one easily see that if you use you go to polar coordinate, you use spherical harmonics, you separate the variables, right? The only non-trivial equation is the radial equation, because the theta phi equation are diagonalized by using the spherical harmonics, right? In the here, something like that works, but you have to deal with the fact that the spinor now is not a scalar, so you have to use the fact that this object is conserved and becomes more involved. But of course, it was done soon after the discovery of the Dirac equation, so and also the correction, relativistic correction to energy levels were found.
J represents the spin half angular.
Yeah.
Is it the only reason that Dirac equation will represent for spin half field?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah. Yes. Right, this is the spinor representation. No? The psi is a representation of the Lorentz group, which is called the spinor representation, as the spatial part is this thing here, and if you look at J3, for example, go to the rest frame, right? Rest frame, we saw that this thing here is just sigma 3 by 2, sigma 3 by 2, right? And this is the spin half, right? Eigenvalue is half. I stress that, right? The fact that when you look at this Lorentz transformations in the spin or using the gamma matrices, you find that they are not single-valued, right? When you do a 2-pi rotation, they pick a minus sign. This is precisely because of this half. This would not be true for spin 1, for example, where there is no half, and the 2-pi rotation is the identity. Okay, this is one of the typical features of spinor representations. Like, well, this is same for SU2, right? SO3, SU2. Right, yeah. One of the things that I wanted to discuss, which is not in the which is in the lectures, the notes I gave, I don't know if you got some extra notes, they contain also this discussion. They contain what we discussed, and it is not there in the previous note, like these things. Coherent states and density matrix, few things that we did, right? And the extra thing I want to discuss is something which is not, which again is at the heart of quantum field theory, and this is from the purely mathematical point of view, is just studying representations of the Poincaré group of the Poincaré algebra, okay? Which means including also Poincaré is it involves, right, the Lorentz generators and the rotations. They form an algebra, which we wrote, right? MM is the structure is this, MP is P, and PP is zero, no? This was the schematically what is the algebra, right? Now it turns out that the representation of this group or algebra, okay, first of all, if you are is interested in the unitary representations, they must be infinite dimensional.
Why do you want to study unitary representations? What is the objective?
Well, unitarity is very important, right? Is the fact that, I mean, amplitudes have a probabilistic interpretation, right? Yeah. Matrix elements, no? So unitarity is important from that point of view.
Okay, unitary representations would be because of that, that you can...
I think so, yeah.
Okay, we have to look at amplitudes.
What we do in quantum field theory, the next course will be to study scattering amplitudes, right?
Yeah.
Scattering amplitudes involves states, incoming states and outgoing states, right? That represent the particles that you scatter, right? I have electrons going, coming, and photons going, okay? Now, these states are what? These are called single particle states. That are states which describe the particle that you are studying, say the electron, which is a spin half object, can be massive, or if you study massless spin half object, like say the neutrino some many years ago was thought to be massless. Okay. It turns out that the single particle states are just unitary representations of the Poincaré group. Okay, this is the statement. This is an approach which not in all books on quantum field theory is taken. It is there in the Weinberg book where you start with this to begin with, because this is what you define to be the objects of your study.
You start with beginner's theorem sometimes.
Yeah, right. I think conceptually is the right framework, but you can live without that, of course, because if you want to know in practice how to do scattering amplitude, that's not a problem, right? But I want just to mention that without going in full detail how this is done, and they are infinite dimensional because they depend on some momentum, continuum momentum, so in this sense they are infinite dimensional, as you will see. Okay, so what is the idea? The idea is very simple. So consider we have to find a representation of this and that. No? So let's start by considering the P, and consider P to be diagonal, so we consider its eigenvalue is P mu, right? And so there are two main cases, right? One is, and this P mu is on shell, so it describes some form momentum of a physical particle, okay? So there are two possibilities, either it is massive or massless. So there are two possibilities, P square is equal to M square, right? Or P square equal to zero. These are the two possibilities, right? That you have. So the first thing you do, so suppose you take this case, the massive case, what you do is to choose a particular, so in this case you can go to the rest frame, right? In the rest frame, you can take P mu to be M zero. No, this is what you do, what we did also. Okay? Whereas in this case, you cannot go to the rest frame. You can choose a convenient form momentum, right? For example, you can choose the momentum P mu to be, say, E, the energy is E, and then it flies in the along the third direction, for example, okay? It's just a choice. So this is light-like, this is time-like. So this describes massive, this massless. Now, suppose now, so now what you do is to look for the subgroup of the Lorentz group which leaves these two vectors invariant. For example, in this case, what is the subgroup of the Lorentz group which leaves this invariant? What do you think? Just a rotation, so three, right? Because the boost would bring some momentum. So in this case, so this is called the little group. Is the subgroup of SO 3,1 which leaves invariant. Let me call this momentum Q to mean that it is some particular momentum which leaves invariant Q. Okay? So in this case this is SO 3. Okay, and so in this case what you have? You have at rest, you have a particle of mass m, right? And then this can be in some representation of SO3 depending on the spin, right? No, the representation of SO3, you know very well what they are. They are labeled by J, right? So there is a mass, then let me call it S actually, and S3. This you can put it like that. Right? The states here are labeled by, okay, the mass is, and then the S3 quantum number. So there are two S plus one states, right? And S can be half integer, for example, for spin half, it would be half, and then S3 would be half minus half. So we have a multiplet of states depending on the third component of the spin along the third direction. Okay, this is a multiplet of SO3. Now, what about this case here, Q, the light-like momentum? What is the invariant? What would be in this case the invariance of the group? So you have a particle flying in the third direction with the velocity of light, no? And what gives, what is an obvious, there is an obvious candidate for the invariant of this. What about if you do a rotation around the third axis, right? You do like that, J3.
We do the rotation in the xy plane.
Yeah. Okay. Around, yeah, this is, say, 1, 2. This leaves this invariant, right? Because at 1, 2 only affect this part, but this is 0, so it remains 0. So there is an obvious, in this case, so this case was SO3, in this case there is an obvious SO2, right, which is this rotation. And which is generated by J3, right? Or M12, which is the same as J3. Which is the rotation in this two, this 1-2 plane. Now, you see, the difference between the two cases is a big difference, because this is a non-abelian group, right? It involves a full multiple. This is an abelian group, SO2 is abelian, right? So, the irreducible representation of SO2 are labeled by what? Are one-dimensional, right? Because this is the only irreducible representation. If you have bigger, higher dimension, you can always break into one-dimensional terms. And they are labeled by this quantum number, J3, and they are integer or half-integer. They are in this set, 0, plus or minus half, plus or minus 1, plus or minus 3 half. Each of these numbers specifies an irreducible representation of SO2, and this is nothing but the helicity, right? Because this is precisely the projection of the angular momentum on the direction of flight, right? So this is the helicity. So we have two different situations, whether the particle is massive or massless. In the massive case, you have a full multiplet, SO3 multiplet, with 2s plus 1 states. In this case, the reducible representation is just a single state, because there is only one number here, say 0 or half or minus half, right? The reducible representation are one dimensional. The group element would be G, say, e to the I lambda theta, right? Lambda is this, and theta is this angle, right? And notice that if lambda is half integer, again, even this is not single valued, right? Because 2 pi rotation is minus 1, right? It's the same, also in this abelian case. So then, a massless particle is characterized, you may say, by, say, so instead of having states like that, you can label them by, say, the energy and the helicity, lambda. Okay? So, well, lambda is one of these numbers. Okay, so this is the situation for this particular frame. This is the rest frame, or this frame, which is just a convenient choice for this light-like vector, right? Q squared equal to 0 here, Q squared equal to m squared here, right? Now, there is a slight subtlety that This is the obvious invariant of this vector, but actually there is more, and the way to see it, you may consider again one exercise to look at the Pauli-Lubansky vector, W mu, and I say this is sigma. Sigma mu rho, right? This sigma. we already saw that in the case of the massive in the massive case W0 is 0 and WI is proportional to the spin, right? So okay, this is. But what happens in the massless case? In the massless case, we have that P, this actually this is Q, no? This that this is 0 or 3, no? So suppose you take W0 here, if this is W0, this is 0, right? And this has to be 3, right? And this has to be 1, 2. Right. So now one has to be careful with the size. So first of all, when you do this calculation, you have to tell me what is your convention. Let's say this is plus 1. Okay. So this is the 1 half goes away because there are two possibilities here, right? This is sigma 1, 2, right? This is 1, 2, 0. 1, 2, and this is 3, so this is E, no? But this is just J3, right? No? 1, 2, no? Up to this energy, because this has dimensions of an energy, right? So you can divide by E if you wish. What about W3? W3 will be similar, right? Because then this is 3 and sigma can be 0, right? So you have, say, 1 half epsilon 3, this is 0, and this is 1, 2 or 2, 1. Again, the same structure, right? Right? So this is with the appropriate sign, this is again sigma 1, 2, E. So again, the zero and the third component are proportional up to this E factor, which, let me put like that, are essentially the Lissity operator. Eigenvalues are given by this. Okay. It would be nice if this W1 and W2 were 0. But actually, this is not the case. Yeah, you know, if this were 0, then you could say the W mu is the Lissity, right? Say lambda, times P mu, right? Q mu, sorry. If this were 0, this would be proportional, this is the E, no? So this Pauli-Lubansky would be just proportional to the momentum, four momentum, up to a number which is the energy, okay, that is fine, and the Lissity. This is essentially true. This is essentially true because one can set to zero this W1, W2. Let me just mention this. This is a subtlety which is usually in many books you find that W mu is lambda Q mu, right? Which is true. But it requires some qualification. Because if you compute W1, W2 here, you find, well, let's see, W1. You have to just put here 1, say, right? 1. Now, this can be, sigma can be 0 or 3, right? So you have epsilon, 1 half, epsilon, 1. Ij 0, right? Sigma ij and E, because Q0 is E. But then you can have also plus 1 half epsilon 3 ij, sorry, 1 here. Ij 3 ij, so we said 1, ij, no, right, so this can be, we said 3, so this is 3, and this can be 0 or 1, right?
0 or 2.
0 or 2, sorry, yeah. Plus 2, 0, so this would be sigma 0, 2. And then the 2, 0, right? So I can always write like that. Huh? Remove the minus sign. This is sigma, so we said this is 1. Well, we have to be careful, yeah, okay. This is 2, 3, right? Or 3, 2. So let's put 2, 3 here. And remove the sign. This is 2, 3.
There would be D
and
E. Huh? There would be an E.
Missing.
Any E here? Anything else? Okay. But E is in overall. The E is always there. You can as well divide by. So this is what? You can move here the 0, right? You pick a minus sign. This is minus sigma 2, 3. E. Let me divide by, okay, W1 already. Sigma 2, 3, okay. And then here, if I move 1, 2, 3, like that, there is a minus sign again, right? Minus sigma 0, 2. No. Okay. Which I can write also, I find it better to write 2, 0, like that. If you do W2 over E, you find that this is, so this is 0, 3, and this is something like, well, let's do that. W2, we said, is 1 half epsilon 2, ij 0 sigma ij over e, right, plus 2 1 half epsilon 2, this is in this case 3, no, 0 I 3 sigma 0 I, no, should be like that, and this is, so this is this goes away. So this is 2, 1, 3. And this is also 1. Okay. So you get some combination. So let's put 3 here. This is minus sigma. If I move the 0 here, I pick a minus sign, then I change also this, another minus sign, this is plus sigma 1, 3, and here is 1, here, 1, right, and move the 2 here, there is no sign, plus sigma 0, 1, and which I can write 1, 0. So you have this, so W1 and W2 have these the combinations of the Lorentz generator. Okay? So they are not zero, right? Because we get something here, right? However, related to that, you can verify that these generators, let me call them more general, these are M instead of sigmas, M23 and M20, right? These combinations are additional, so we said that what lives invariant this vector is for sure M12, okay? M12 is there. However, you can check that this combination of M's, say M13 minus M10, and m 2,0 minus m 2,3. Also leave invariant this, so leave q mu, which is e 0, 0. So it is not only, so this was j, the density, but there are these additional things. So the little group is a bit more complicated than, I mean, it's not so intuitive that this, there are these additional objects here. And now, the logic is, like here, we said, the representation or representation of the little group, in this case, just SO3, that is not a problem. However, if you take seriously this algebra, you have to study the representation of this algebra, okay? Which is not the same as J, because J was just a U1, which is easy, we know that, right? So this algebra is more complicated, because you can verify that this is the algebra of rotations in the plane and translation. This is like some P1, this is some P2, and the algebra is JP1 is P2, and JP2 is minus P1. This is the algebra generated by rotations in the plane and the two translation in this way. In some fictitious plane, eh? It's not a physical. Okay. And now if you study this, I don't want to enter into the discussing this. The representation of this are infinite dimensional, they involve infinite spins here, an infinite number of spins, the eigenvalue of J, unless you set P equal to 0, this P1 and P2, which are these things here, to 0. So you select a particular representation, okay, in which these are set to 0. So in this sense, this is true, the sense that these two are 0, because we select a particular representation of this algebra. Okay? And so, the conclusion is that if you do that, you choose that particular representation, then the single particle states describing massless particles are characterized by, okay, the energy and the single number, which is the least. That's all. Okay? The problem is that these other complicated representations, they seem not to have any particular physical meaning. So the only physical meaning is where you can set to 0 these objects here. Okay. So this is the conclusion. So this is the half of the story. Check the sign here. I'm not sure about this, the signs of this, but it's essentially is essentially correct, the calculation. So then we can set this to 0, and then we have the situation that I said. So in conclusion, in this particular reference frame, rest frame for the massive particle, and this particular frame where you choose some direction of flight, the states of the particle are characterized by these states here. In this case, you have a representation of SO3, and in this case, even simpler, you have just a single number, the density, along the direction of flight. Now, what then? But you can say, what then? Why should I allow to just look at this particular reference frame? No? How this defines a representation of the full Poincaré group. This is what we want, right? The point is that the main point, which it was this discovered, I mean, was worked out by Wigner, was that after you have these states, these particular states, which are characterized by this momenta, you can lift them to a full representation of the Poincaré group. Okay. And they give rise to infinite dimensional irreducible representation of not just of these subgroups, but of the full Poincaré group. Okay. So this is the logic. So from the little group, which is the simple thing here, SO3 or SO2 in the two cases, you are able to lift it to the full Poincaré algebra involving all the generators, not just these subgroup generators. Okay. Let me just briefly mention how this works. First of all, you choose states which are eigenstates of the momentum, in the sense that p mu, this is just the p mu, ps, where s is some additional quantum number. This is the momentum. This can be the spin, for example, okay, like that, or the least. So you choose a basis which is basis of eigenstates of the momentum. And then what is the goal here? If I give you some arbitrary Lorentz transformation, you should tell me what is the action of how this, say this is a Lorentz transformation, this is some representation of that, how this acts on this, right? This is what is the meaning of representation. Some matrix acting on some basis, right? Mixing this basis, right? This is what is the meaning of representation. So I should be able to find what is this, right? How this acts on this. If I'm solving that, then I found the representation. Okay? And this P is a general form momentum. Okay? Not one of these. Because otherwise. Okay. Now what can you say about this? Well, this, you know, this should be some linear combination as some with some coefficient, linear combination of this thing, S prime. Why? Because whatever this state here is, it should give me some momentum lambda p. So this should be an eigenstate of p with eigenvalue lambda p, right? Up to a mixing of this quantum number here, right? If I apply p mu to this state, p mu on this, I get lambda p mu, right? Which is this eigenvalue here. The goal is to determine what are these things, right? No, we don't know. We know that there is a linear combination of this. And so the goal is to determine this. These are finite dimensional matrices, right? Mixing these quantum numbers here, right? They may depend on P. They will depend on P, actually. So now one uses this idea of the little group and this particular reference frame. And we can say that, okay, our state PS is obtained from QS, where Q is, remember, Q was, take the massive case, was this. In this case, you can get an arbitrary form momentum by a boost, right? Okay? So let me, the boost which takes Q to P, let me denote but L of P. So my state is defined to be G of L of P. acting on the on this state gives me some state with arbitrary momentum. Okay, and so the goal is to find how this general, this is a general Lorentz transformation. This is a particular Lorentz transformation which takes me Q to P. Okay, and this is defined not uniquely, right? Because if I multiply this on the right with an element of the little group does not affect Q, right? So the little group, let me call it W, is such that W on Q is equal to Q by definition, right? It's the group which leaves invariant this vector. So this is the little group. Right? So I can change L by acting on, with an element of W on the right. I will not change this, right? So there is a choice here that you have to make. It's not uniquely defined.
So it is something kind of like...
Eh? Yeah, it's a, you can define it as a coset of the full Lorentz group by elements of the little group, right? Okay. So then an idea to see what is this G of lambda acting on this is G of lambda acting on this, right? Which I can write is using the group property. This is the same of G lambda LP on QS, right? And I recall it that G lambda 1, G lambda 2 is G lambda 1, lambda 2, right? By the group properties. Okay? Now, let's do a trivial thing and multiply this by 1 here, put an identity here, which is this object here, which is G of L of lambda P, G minus 1 of L of lambda P. This is 1, right? What is L of lambda P? Is the boost which takes me Q not to L of to P but to lambda P, no? Q apply L of lambda P brings me to lambda P. That's all, right? Is this, and then we have these things here. G lambda and then L of P on QS, right? I've done nothing, just this is 1. Okay. But now look at this term here. What is this term? What is this group element, the product of these things here? Okay, so the first step, this what it does, it takes Q to P, no? By definition, right? This takes, so Q goes to P with L of P. Then there is lambda. Lambda takes to lambda P. Right? And then this is what? This is the inverse of this transformation. This takes lambda P to Q back, right? So this is what? This says that this element here is an element of the little group, belongs to the little group W. Right? But then, we know how this starts here, right? Because this was the starting point. Now this is some state in the reference frame that we chosen, right? The mass, say, the rest frame. This is an element of the little group. So this action here is nothing but, in the case of the massive particle, an SO3 transformation. So the little group is SO3. So this is, well, I can continue this and say that this is G of L of lambda P, which is this thing here, times some matrix D, let me call it D, S, S prime, acting on Q S prime. And this is, in the case of the massive particle, just an SO3 transformation, which we know, because we know the representation of SO3. This is an S by S, 2S plus 1, this is 2S plus 1 times 2S plus 1 matrix, right? So SO3 we know how to deal with, no? So these are numbers, right? These are numbers acting on this, and but that this thing here I can move to up here, no? And this is D S S prime, and now I use this definition. This tells me that this is nothing but, you know, Q taken to not P like before, but lambda P. So this is lambda P S prime.
That C,
SS
prime, are SO3 elements.
Yeah, this means that. So, you know, the starting point was this. And the arrival point was this one. So, this means that we know what is the action of an arbitrary Lorentz transformation on this arbitrary state PS. Arbitrary in the sense this is an arbitrary form momentum. Is given by the representation of the little group, right? Which, as you can see, it will depend on P, right? Because this depends on P, no? So, but the now why I'm saying that this gives unitary infinite dimensional representations. Well, infinite dimensional because this depends on a continuous variable here, this object here, not just a set of numbers, right? P all it does is to be on one shell, P squared equal to m squared, for example, in the massive case, but otherwise is a continuous variable, right? So this infinite dimensional, but is unitary. Why it's unitary? Because these are unitary matrices. No? Representation of SO3 are unitary. Right?
It's not just infinite, it's non-denominable because
P. Yeah, because P, yeah, right, right. So this is the idea. So this is the idea, and so the conclusion is that this, starting from the little group where we know what are the representations, because it's easy, it's a simple thing, SO3 or SO2. And this can be lifted up in the Poincaré, on the Poincaré level, right? In this way.
So we can say that on the Hilbert space of spaces, of states, the representation of the Poincaré group is infinite dimensional.
Yes. Okay. Yeah, it's infinite dimensional, but also unitary.
Unitary.
Okay, if it was finite dimensional, there was no way it could be unitary.
Because irreducible, right?
Eh?
Irreducible.
Irreducible also, yeah. Yeah.
And this is also, these operators are also linear, right?
Yeah, they are matrices.
So can it happen that if we allow them to be anti-linear, then it would be anti-unitary?
Yeah, but we don't allow that, right? We take the standard representation of SO3. Say, if we have, say, particle, right, can have spin zero, in which case these are just singlets, right? Spin half, massive spin half, the electron positron, right, in which case they are 2 by 2. Spin one, massive spin one, these are 3 by 3, and so on. These are, I mean, for every spin, these objects here are known. are also known as Wegener function. You can find that on the tables, it's not a problem. But what I want to stress is the logic, the idea, then the details one can.
Okay. No, but if we are talking about Lorentz transformations here, okay. But if we talk about something else, about like Wigner time reversal, then it would be antilinear.
Okay, Wigner time reversal, yeah, that is antilinear. Yeah. So this is the statement that single particle states, in other words, single particle states, which are the states that you use that enter in when you do calculation of scattering processes, okay, are the same essentially as irreducible representations, unitary irreducible representation of the Poincaré group or algebra. Okay. This is the message. And this works both for the, I was here essentially considering the case of the massive particle, but it works also for the massless ones, in which case, you know, is even simpler, because this, for the massless case, we said the irreducible representation are the one of SO2, O2, which is abelian, and they are just one dimension. So this means they are phases. For SO2, they are phases. These are phases, which can depend on P, okay, that is not, but they are phases.
But if we were in higher dimensions, then they would be, for example, SO3 or something.
Yeah, yeah, higher dimensions is more the...
They wouldn't be abelian.
Already right. Okay. For instance, in, you go to 5 dimensions, it would be, yes. Yeah, non-abelian, starting to be non-abelian, right. Even the massive particles would not just be rank 1, like SO3, but would be higher rank rotation groups, right? So in 5 dimensions, massive particle in 5 dimensions is controlled by SO4, right? And so as you go up, decrease. So it is a feature of 4 dimensions, the fact that the massless particle is just controlled by a single number, the helicity. In higher dimension, of course, this is not true anymore. Right, so this is the idea. And this is the sort of, I think, this is at the heart of quantum field theory. But for some reasons, actually the only book which starts with this, which many more details, of course, is Weinberg's book. But you see, the idea in itself is simple. There is some similar construction which does not give unitary representation of... this is a construction done, so to speak, in momentum space, right? Because the essential feature that we work with the four momentum, which is on mass shell, it satisfies the mass shell condition. Okay, so it describes a physical particle, right? Like an asymptotic state of a scattering amplitude are on shell, they define they have a mass, a definite mass, right? There is a construction which is to some extent similar on in configuration space, in X space, which is all, which you will do also in quantum field theory, is when you deal with fields, no? We had our psi of X, right? The spin of field, or the A mu of X, right? And so on, no? Question is, how these objects, how do they transform under Poincaré transformations? Okay. like we did here for this momentum space description. Or Lorentz, because we said no, psi prime x prime was s of lambda psi of x. No, this is what we said for the spin, right? How does this arise from a more sort of formal way of understanding? Okay. Well, there is a way, which is the following. So suppose we are interested to study Lorentz transformation, like say g of lambda, g minus 1 lambda, phi of x, or psi of x, g of lambda. What is this? This is an operator, g of lambda, acting on some field, psi of x. Okay? What is this thing here? Well, the thing is the following. You start with x equal to 0. Okay, which is the origin of, you know, the complication here is that you have also what happens to the argument of the field, right? If this was a set of numbers like you do in the group theory code, there is no x here, right? So there is no issue, like, because we know that the Lorentz transformation acts also on the space-time point, right? So this is the complication compared to the when you study representation in vector spaces, right? But if you restrict to x equal to 0, so psi of 0, then we know what this is, right? G minus 1 of lambda, psi of 0, g of lambda. Since 0 under Lorentz transformation remains 0, okay, this will be some s of lambda, psi of 0, right? No? Because there is no problem in having the argument is just x equal to 0, lambda of 0 is equal to 0, so this is so should be. Okay? But then how can we get this g minus 1 psi of x g of lambda? This is what we want, right? Because our field depends on space-time coordinates, right?
But if we apply the finite space-time translation of
exactly, this is what you do. So you may say here, if you want to keep some parallel with what we do, is that x equal to 0, what is the little group of x equal to 0 in the Poincaré group? It's the full Lorentz group, right? Any Lorentz transformation leaves this invariant. Right? So this is the little group. It's different from the previous one. So Lorentz group, by the way, is non-compact. So it's not, it's unlike the situation here, but at least if you don't worry about that, so then you have so g minus 1 of lambda g of lambda, and then as he was suggesting, phi of x can be obtained by e to the minus px phi of 0 or psi of 0 e to the I px, right? This is psi of x. Okay. Why this is useful? Because suppose you do g minus 1 here, e to the minus I p dot x, insert both here and here an identity, g minus 1, the same, phi of 0, right? G e to the I P X, right? G G minus G G minus 1. This is what we have, right? I inserted the identity here and here, right? Okay. But now this is, we know what it is, because this is nothing but some matrix acting on the indices, just on the indices of the field. This is S of lambda psi at 0, right? This is this. No? So we use the fact that we know what are the representation of the little group, which in this case is the Lorentz group.
Okay.
And then you have this. But what is this? It looks complicated, but it is not complicated. Because, you see, g minus 1, a to the minus I px, g, this is the Lorentz transformation. You can exponentiate this, right? What I'm saying, this is the same as e to the minus I, g minus 1, p, g, x, right? This is a number. This is what it does, right? If you expand this in power series, I mean, g minus 1, only the outer ones remain, right? The rest cancels. But this is what? This is a Lorentz transformation on the four momentum, right? So this is e to the minus I lambda p x, which I can write e to the minus I p lambda minus 1 x. So then, if you follow me, this is on the left, you have e to the minus I p lambda minus 1 x here. On the, this is phi of psi of 0 with this s here, which acts on the indices here, right? E to the I p lambda minus 1 x also here. But this s is numbers, right? This acts on the field only, right? So this is s, say alpha beta, psi beta, of what? Now, what is the argument? It's shifted by, not x, by lambda minus 1 x. Right? So this is lambda minus 1 x. Right? So conclusion is that g minus 1 of lambda psi alpha of x g of lambda, which I can call psi prime of x, is this thing here. Okay? Now, why this is the same as this one? Because, let me write it. Can I do it here? Because, you know, I have that. Where did I write it? Yeah, here, no? Psi prime of x is s psi lambda minus 1 x, right? Remember that x prime is lambda x. Right? But I can just redefine both left and right, right? If I send x to lambda x, this becomes psi prime of lambda x, which is x prime, is s or lambda psi of x, which is precisely what we postulated when we did this transformation for the spinor. But this is true for any, you give me any object which transforms like a representation of the Lorentz group, I can promote the corresponding field in this way, where this acts on the indices. Okay? So again, from the representation of the little group, which in this case is Lorentz, we lift to the full Poincaré group, which means including the position also. The difference is what? That these are not unitary representations. Unless this is one for the scalar. Because S are not unitary matrices, right? Because this is a representation of the Lorentz group, not of the little group that we described. OK? Okay, and so there is a similarity, but moreover, you know, these fields here, when you define the deformation, they are not supposed to obey any equation of motion. They are arbitrary, right? Whereas the states that we defined in the momentous pair were space, were on mass shell, so they satisfy the equation of motion, the free equation of motion, right? This is the difference. So they are truly describing the physical degrees of freedom of the particle, whereas this is not. Of course, this is useful, these things are useful to discuss the Lagrangian, the Hamiltonian formulation in quantum field theory, as you will see. So this is what I wanted to say about this. So I gave you something to check. I think now this checking this commutation of not for today, no.
Okay. You should have stopped the recording.
Yeah.